This is Chicago, Illinois. Serving a population of 9.8 million people, a network of commuter rail lines connects this U.S. city, servicing 255 stations across 12 counties and 3 states. Consisting of 12 lines and 563 miles of track, the system travels across Chicago, with electric and diesel trains radiating from downtown to the suburbs. But how did the system grow from its original stations to the network it is today? My name's Zach, and this is the evolution of the network. Thanks to my subscribers who helped research and provided footage for this video. You can find links to their social media in the description below. Chicago's Regional Transportation Authority began subsidizing operations of Chicago's commuter rail network in May 1975, providing financial assistance to the Chicago, South Shore, and South Bend Railroad. Departing from Randolph Street Station in downtown Chicago, the line ran subsidized to Hagwisch, before continuing unsubsidized to South Bend, Indiana. 3 months later in August, subsidies also began to the Norfolk and Western Railway, subsidizing a single round trip to and from Chicago. Trains ran from Orland Park to Polk Street in downtown, stopping outside the former Dearborn Station. Subsidy agreements were reached with more commuter rail operators in March 1976, with trains on Milwaukee Road's North and West lines being subsidized. Departing from Chicago's Union Station, the West Line made 20 stops to Elgin, while the North Line traveled to Fox Lake, with limited trips continuing north to Walworth, Wisconsin. 1 month later in April, a subsidy agreement was also reached with the Illinois Central Gulf Railroad, adding 2 additional lines to the subsidized network. The electric line ran south from Randolph Street Station to Richland Park, with branches running to 91st Street and Blue Island. A second line ran from Union Station to Joliet, running limited peak hour trips. The Burlington Northern Railroad reached a subsidy agreement with the RTA 1 month later, with subsidized operations beginning in May between Chicago's Union Station and Aurora. In October, operations on the Rock Island line also began to be subsidized, running from Joliet to Chicago's LaSalle Street Station on 2 separate branches. 2 months later, in December, the Norfolk and Western Line station at Polk Street was closed, with trains being rerouted to end at Union Station instead. A final subsidy agreement was signed in January 1977 with the Chicago and Northwestern Transportation Company. 3 lines operated from Chicago and Northwestern Station in downtown, running west to Geneva, north to Kenosha, Wisconsin, and northwest to Harvard, with a limited service branch to Richmond. 3 months later in April, the Rock Island station at Englewood was closed due to low ridership, speeding up service through Chicago. In November, service on the Illinois Central Gulf Electric Line was extended 1 stop from Richland Park, now ending at a new station at Park Forest South. A monorail was planned to connect from the station to Governor State University and the newly built Park Forest South development. However, the plan was scrapped due to an economic downturn. The state of Indiana began subsidies to the Chicago, South Shore, and South Bend Railroad in June 1978, allowing the entire route to South Bend to continue operations. 1 month later in July, various station closures occurred, affecting inner-city stations on various lines. On the Norfolk and Western line, 5 stations between Union Station and Western Avenue were closed, in addition to the Southmore stop near the south end of the line. On the Rock Island line, the station at Auburn Park was also closed near the end of that year, although we were unable to find an exact date. However, further south, an infill station opened at the end of October, with Rock Island trains now stopping at Tinley Park, 80th Avenue. 2 years later, in August 1980, service on the Chicago and Northwest branch to Richmond was cut back 2 stops, with trains now ending at McHenry. The South Shore line stop at Port Chester was also removed from the timetable around this time, although we were unable to find an exact date. Station closures continued 2 years later in July 1982, with the South Shore line stop at Calumet Harbor being discontinued. Weekend trains on the line began stopping at 23rd Street later that month, providing service to the McCormick Place Convention Center. The Milwaukee District North line into Wisconsin was cut back 3 months later in October, closing 4 stations between Walworth and Fox Lake. 2 station closures also occurred later in October, with trains no longer stopping on the Rock Island line at Hamilton Park, and on the South Shore line at Buchanan. The following month, an infill station opened on the Milwaukee District West line, with trains now stopping at Schaumburg. The electric line station at Park Forest South was also renamed to University Park around this time, reflecting the name change of the surrounding area. Various low ridership stations on the network were closed in May 1984 as a cost-cutting measure. On the Milwaukee District North Line, Wilson Road was closed, while the C&NW Northwest Line saw the closure of Heartland. The Joliet Line saw station closures at Halsted Street and Brighton Park, while the Rock Island Line saw station closures at 99th and Givens on the main branch. Finally, on the North Fork Southern Line, Western Avenue was closed, along with the ICG Electric Line station at 67th Street. The South Shore Line station at Midwest was also closed around this time, although we were unable to confirm an exact date. On the Norfolk Southern Line, the station at Landers was also renamed to Wrightwood. South Shore Line service to 57th Street was discontinued in July, with trains stopping instead at 59th Street. An additional station on the Milwaukee District North Line closed in November of that year, with trains no longer stopping at Rondout. The Milwaukee District West Line was extended further into Elgin in March 1986, now ending at a new suburban station at Big Timber Road. On the South Shore Line, the stops at Tremont and Bailey closed 3 months later in June, being replaced by an upgraded station nearby at Dune Park. That same year, the C&NW North Line station at Abbott's Platform was closed, having previously been served by limited trips. 2 years later, in 1988, the Heritage Corridor station at 5th Street was closed. An additional station on the Heritage Corridor closed in 1989, with trains no longer stopping at Glen. That July, a new station was opened on the Burlington Northern Line at Route 59, providing additional parking spaces for the overcrowded Aurora and Naperville stations. Today, this is the busiest commuter rail station outside of downtown Chicago. The Norfolk Southern Line was extended further into Orland Park in June 1990, with an additional station opening at 153rd Street. The original Orland Park station became 143rd Street, better identifying its location for commuters. On the South Shore Line, the end terminal in South Bend was relocated 2 years later in November 1992, moving from the Amtrak station to a new terminus at the South Bend Airport. The line used an existing low-speed freight spur owned by the railway, with planning for a faster and more direct route to the airport now underway. 2 months later, in January 1993, an additional station opened on the Rock Island Line, with trains now stopping at Hickory Creek. Later that year, the Metra Electric Line station at 137th Street was renamed to Riverdale, although we were unable to confirm an exact date. More station closures occurred on the South Shore Line in July 1994, closing 7 underutilized stops on the route in Indiana. That December, the South Shore Line station at Shops was renamed to Carroll Avenue, better identifying its location. 1 month later, in January 1995, the Southwest service was extended further into Orland Park once again, now ending at a new stop at 179th Street. The following year, in January 1996, an additional station was added to the Milwaukee District North Line, with the opening of a stop at Lake Cook. A 12th line was added to the network in August 1996, the first new line constructed under the Regional Transportation Authority. The new North Central service shared tracks with the Milwaukee District West Line from Union Station to River Grove, before branching off north to service 11 new stations to Antioch. 6 months after its launch in February 1997, trains on the route also began stopping at Western Avenue, offering connections to other Milwaukee District lines. The terminus for the Union Pacific lines in downtown Chicago was renamed in October 1997, now being known as Ogilvie Transportation Center. 2 years later, in May 1999, the Metro Electric and South Shore Line station at 23rd Street was also renamed to McCormick Place, better identifying this major landmark. An infill station was opened on the Milwaukee District North Line 2 years later in January 2001, with trains now stopping at Glen of North Glenview. 5 months later in June, the Metro Electric 91st Street branch was extended one stop, now ending at a new station at South Chicago. The previous 91st Street station was also closed at this time, improving stop spacing on this branch. 2 years later, in late 2003, the South Shore Line station at Clark Road was renamed to Gary Chicago Airport, reflecting its location near this transportation hub. In April 2004, trains on the Milwaukee District North Line began stopping at Prairie Crossing, with a new set of platforms being constructed near the existing North Central service ones. 1 month later in May, South Shore Line trains began stopping once again at 57th Street, replacing the nearby stop at 59th Street. On the Southwest service, an infill station was opened 7 months later in December, with trains now stopping at Palos Heights. In September 2005, an infill station was opened on the Union Pacific Northwest Line, with trains now stopping at Pingree Road. In downtown Chicago, Randolph Street Station was renamed to Millennium Station in late 2005, marking the completion of an almost 20-year renovation. January 2006 saw the extension of the Union Pacific West Line to Elburn, including an intermediate stop at La Fox. Later that week, four more stations were opened on the North Central service, with trains now stopping at Washington Street, Rosemont, Schiller Park, and Belmont Avenue. That same day, a one-stop extension of the Southwest service opened, with trains now ending at Manhattan. The existing line was also upgraded as part of this extension, allowing an increase in service along the entire route. 10 months later in October, an infill station was opened on that stretch, with trains now stopping at Laraway Road. In December, the Milwaukee District West Line stations at Cragin and Hermosa were closed, being replaced by a combined stop at Grand Cicero. 4 months later in April 2007, the BNSF line saw its first change in 18 years, with the closure of Clyde Station. 2 years later, in February 2009, the Metro Electric and South Shore Line station at Roosevelt Street was renamed to Museum Campus 11th Street, reflecting its location near numerous Chicago museums and attractions. 2 years later, in April 2011, an infill station was opened on the Rock Island Line at 35th Street, improving access to U.S. Cellular Field and the Illinois Institute of Technology. In February 2012, the South Shore Line stop at Kensington was discontinued as part of a realignment of the station, with the stop now only being served by Metro Electric trains. Finally, in February 2018, an infill station was opened on the Heritage Corridor, with trains now serving a new stop at Romeoville. This brings us to the Chicago commuter rail map that we know today. In the years to come, new stations and lines are planned for the Chicago commuter rail network, expanding access to the system. In May 2023, an infill station will be added on the Union Pacific North Line, with trains now stopping at Peterson Ridge. 1 year later, in December 2024, the Rock Island Line station at Auburn Park will reopen, bringing service back to the station after a 45-year absence. Finally, in February 2025, a new branch of the South Shore Line will open, providing new service to northwestern Indiana. Branching off south from Hammond Station, the line will service three new stops to Munster-Dyer Main Street, including a rebuilding of Hammond Station into the Hammond Gateway. That was the evolution of Chicago's commuter rail network, giving us the 12 lines that we know today. If you haven't already, be sure to watch our video on the evolution of the Chicago L network, which you can access by clicking the button in the top right corner. Don't forget to leave a like if you enjoyed this video, and comment down below to join in the discussion. My name's Zach, and I'll be vanishing underground until the next one.